Pleasure to introduce the next speaker for going further in the research field. Research that is being done both at academic level and all the companies are working on it also. And it's especially a pleasure to have Mathieu Pernot here from the Institut Langevin here in Paris. And when you look in the research field in ultrasound, actually lately most of this research is actually done, I think the most advanced research is done in Europe. And there's a couple of centers working in this. And you have Norway, which is very closely related to GE. And then Leuven, Jan Dogen, is also a little bit working on this. You'll see the next one. But I think one of the major ones doing innovation here is currently the lab where Mathieu is working. And these people are doing kind of everything in advanced imaging, and even also the going from the more academic side towards even trying to get products in the market to do things with it. So it's my pleasure to introduce one of the specialists, I think, currently in Europe and probably in the world in kind of innovative ultrasound imaging, and we're happy to listen to what you have to say to us.
Thank you very much, Bart, for this nice introduction. So it's my pleasure to be here to do this lecture on ultrafast imaging. So the title is, can ultrasound get the whole heart picture? But actually, I hope I will convince you that it can. But well, you will see the limitations also of this. So I'm from Institut Langevin, Paris, in the center of Paris. It is located in the ESPCI, which is a school of engineering in physics in Paris. And in this school, we have a lot of historics in innovation towards medical application. The first people that did a very important work in this field were the Pierre and Marie Curie. They were working at the ESPCI and they discovered radium, and then they applied, Marie Curie applied this discovery for medical application. This is some picture of the ESPCI at the time. It's not like this anymore. And they discovered that it could be used also for medicine. And they created also this Institut du Radium in 1914, which is very close to the ESPCI, that the center of Paris in the 5th district. Institut du Radium is here, and it's now it's called Institut Curie. It's a very famous place for research in cancer and therapy. So we were inspired a lot by these people at the ESPCI in many different research fields. There were also Langevin. Langevin discovered the use of ultrasound for sonar imaging. He was working also there. And in our lab, so our lab is called Wave Physics for Medicine. And we are almost 40 people in this lab. And so we try also to develop new clinical applications from basic concept in wave physics here. And so we work mainly with ultrasound, a little bit with optics also. It's for us it's a bit unusual also because we published in a very technical paper but also in high impact journals such as Nature or in Cardiology, JACC, and other journals in neurology also. And also we in order to develop clinical application we also created several companies which are listed here, in order to go into the clinical market and really to go to the from physics to the medicine. Ecosense was the first one. Ecosense developed a system for grading the liver fibrosis using ultrasound. It was the first system with shear wave elastography. So now it's used in every hospital and has reduced a lot the number of biopsy, of the liver biopsy. There was also supersonic imaging. Supersonic imaging is a company that is commercialized a system for It's the first high frame rate clinical system in ultrasound in the ultrasound market. There is also CardioWave. It's a system for ultrasound non-invasive ultrasound therapy of the heart. And recently, we created NeuroFroze, which is a company for imaging the brain with ultrasound also and doing functional imaging. So one of the main innovations that we wrote was the ultrafast imaging. You already had a very nice introduction from Olivier on it's actually not exactly the same video, but yours is much better, I think. And but the idea of ultrafast imaging is, as you understood, is to use very high frame rate imaging in order to visualize and quantify mechanical waves and very fast phenomenon that occurs, but not only in symbols, but also in the human body, such as mechanical waves. This is not me.
This is
you. No. It's not a student. It's well, it could be. But, so you see the wave propagation, which is very fast. In this example, the wave propagation is about 1 meter per second, several meters per second. But you have other effects. If I go back here, you have also electrical activation here in muscles, in the heart. Electrical conduction in the heart is propagated at several meters per second in the Purkinje fibers, but in the myocardium it's 1 meter, 0.5 meters per second. You have also blood flows, which it's not propagation, but it's motion, very fast motion, on the order of several meters per second sometimes. So for all this phenomenon, ultrasound is a great tool because it's a real-time tool. But sometimes it's not fast enough in using a conventional ultrasound. So I will talk today a little bit about ultrafast imaging principles from 2D to 3D, and then I will show several examples of applications with quantitative imaging of myocardial stiffness, high sensitivity coronary blood flow imaging, 4D flow imaging, and finally with myocardial fiber mapping with ultrasound. So I will go very fast with the basic principle because you already had very good introduction on this. So in conventional ultrasound, we use focus wave. Here, the wave is focused in the medium. Then the wave is backscattered, and then we focus in receive in order to create a line. Which is a line here. It's an example in the brain, but it's working exactly the same way in other application. And so you need to repeat this process in order to build the entire image. This takes time because each transmit here it takes about 100 to 200 microseconds. So at the end, you have 50 to 100 image per second, which is enough for real time, but not for all applications. So in ultrafast imaging, we transmit plane waves or diverging waves, but it's very broad transmission like this. And then we receive all the signals. The signals are stored in memories. And then you use all the signals to make the image, to apply focusing in receive, in parallel focusing here to do the image at the same time. So, of course, as Olivier said, the image quality is decreased, but you can get a very, very high frame rate depending on the depth only. If you image 1 centimeter depth deep or 2 centimeters, you can get a very high frame rate here. As Olivier said, there is also a way to retrieve the imaging quality with plane wave imaging. And it is based on the decomposition of the wave focusing on a plane wave basis, like this. If you use several plane waves, actually you can reconstruct here a focus. So it's a synthetic focus because you don't transmit all the wave at the same time, but you can do it successively. And when you use 40 plane waves in 2D imaging, you can create a great focus, which is the same focus than in conventional focusing. But the great advantage here is that you have the flexibility between frame rate and and the image quality. You can really tune the system for frame rate or image quality. So you have the same example in when you do sector image. So when you do sector image with conventional ultrasound, you have to make lines along the sector. In ultrafast imaging, you create a diverging wave. The diverging wave then illuminates the entire organs, and then you create this image in receive. And you can apply also the same spatial compounding, current compounding strategy, but using a circular wave here by using the summation, the current summation of circular wave in order to create the focus everywhere in the image. So that's another advantage is here you have a synthetic focus everywhere in the image, in transmit and in receive. So you see, it's very simple. Very simple. The principle of ultrafast imaging is very simple. So why was not it was not done before? Because it's linked to the technology capability in ultrasound. And actually, the first guys who did ultrafast imaging of the heart also was in 1976. So they were French guys, and they were using at this time. An optoacoustic system, because the electronics was not fast enough to receive all the signals and process it. So they used a broad emission, and then they received ultrasound that were converted to light directly, and using an interferometer here they created the image in real time, and they imaged the heart at more than 1,000 frames per second. So then there were many people working on this. There was the ExplosoScan and many innovation. In the lab, our first electronics to do that was in 1906, and it was a big electronic, multi-channel programmable electronic. It was designed for time reversal focusing at that time, because it was the same requirements than for ultrafast imaging, And with time, we moved on to a smaller system. And in 2009, this was the first commercial scanner developed by supersonic imaging. That was capable to do ultrafast imaging. And you see, if you look at the progression also, it's the time that was required to process the data. You see that we went from 1 hour in 86 to less than a second in 2009. So this is the main reason why it was not used before. It's because it was too slow in processing, and the increasing capability of CPU, GPU, then with the Moore law, then accelerated a lot the same processing. So it's now real time. It's not possible to do real time imaging at 1,000 frames per second on a conventional computer. So it's completely normal. And now you have a lot of systems that have this capability on the market. On the research part, in the research market, you have Verasonic that sell a system for this, and others, which are basically the similar thing. So what can you see at this frame rate? So this is a very simple example in the carotid artery. If you look at several thousand images per second, you see waves in the carotid artery, so that the arterial wall here. And if you look during the cardiac cycle, you have a big wave here, coming here. So in red, it's moving upward, in blue, downward. And then you have another wave here, just after, which is also moving from the same direction, so from the heart to the brain. This wave is well known. It's the arterial pulse wave. And it was the first image by ultrasound locally, like by Hasegawa in 2001. And it allowed here to quantify locally the arterial pulse wave, which is very interesting for diagnostic and prognostic interest. You have also similar very rapid phenomena, for example, in the muscle. Here it's a contracting muscle during electrical stimulation, and you see this mechanical wave that propagates very fast, several meters per second, in the muscle here. And this can be applied also to the heart, and this was a work done by Jean Prouveau at, during his PhD thesis at Columbia University, and looking with high frame rate how the heart deform during the contraction. And here you can see that you can see that there are deformation here that propagates and moves toward the entire heart here. So you can quantify the activation time for something which is related to the mechanical activation time in milliseconds, and create some map which contains information about the electromechanical activation properties. So this is very exciting also, but very challenging to perform currently in the heart. Then recently also we moved on to 3D imaging. So the principle is exactly the same than in 2D. So in 2D, you have line by line in conventional imaging, line by line focusing. In 3D imaging, you have also line by line focusing, but in order to create an entire volume. So this takes a lot of time, especially in 3D, with a few volume per second, which is not enough even to do real-time imaging. With ultra-fast imaging here, we transmit plane waves. So in 3D you have plane waves that have the 2D extent. It's a plane wave over a surface like this. And with one transmit, you can do the image of a full volume, and you can reach 10,000 volume or 15,000 volume per second for low depth. And you can also use the same principle of coherent compounding in 3D. So this is the system that we built to perform this 3D ultrafast imaging. So it's a research prototype, and you see it's very big, like the one in the 96. It's ugly. It's not adapted to clinical work, but it has a thousand of channels in emission here, and 500 channels in receive, in order to drive this probe, the matrix probe here, which has 1,000 elements, and to perform ultrafast imaging, which is all the beamforming here is computed on GPUs in this PC here. So this system can do ultrafast imaging with plane waves like this, or diverging wave here. So in order to do this, we use what we call virtual sources. Here we place a source somewhere behind the probe, and this source can be very far, so it creates plane wave, or very close, it creates a diverging wave, and then we apply the coherent compounding scheme. You have an example of how works coherent compounding on phantoms here. So this is the contrast improvement of the in a phantom of heart here, with the number of emitted virtual source, and you see that increase very very rapidly, like in 2D, and with 10 or 20 sources, you almost reach the final imaging quality. So you need a little more, 40, 60, and then this is in vivo, same experiment in vivo on the carotida. So the principle is very simple and very similar to 2D. Okay, if there is any question, don't hesitate to interrupt me. Otherwise, I continue. And so the first application that I'm going to talk about is a quantitative imaging of myocardial stiffness using ultrafast imaging. So the context of this work is to provide new diagnostic tools for heart failure, and especially for diastolic heart failure. Diastolic heart failure is a pathology that has a lot of patients. It's approximately half of the heart failure patients now, so it's millions of patients. And the diagnostic of heart failure appears is very difficult, because the heart appears completely normal at the echocardiography. The contraction is normal, so it's very difficult to see the failure here. And we know also that the main mechanism here is the increase of myocardial stiffness, which cannot be quantified currently by any techniques, non-invasive techniques, such as ultrasound, MRI, or other. So why cannot be quantified? It's because stiffness, when you go back to the physical property, stiffness is measured by the elasticity of tissue, and the elasticity is quantified by the Young's modulus, for example, here, E, which is a ratio between the stress and the strain that is applied on the tissue. So current technique allow to measure deformation, the strain, here, but not the stress. It's impossible to know what is the real stress inside the muscle. So it's not possible to quantify exactly the Young's modulus currently. But there are other techniques, of course, that can do that. And this is what we call the human body seismology. It is exactly what you saw at the beginning with the big punch on the belly and the wave propagating. So in the human body, you have different type of waves. You have compressional waves that propagate very fast, like ultrasound, and you have shear waves that propagate slowly, but still at fast, at several meters per second. And when you look at the physics, you see that compressional waves has velocity that are linked to the bulk modulus here, and which is very high in tissue because tissue are incompressible. It's almost water. It's very difficult to compress tissue. But shear waves here are linked to the shear modulus, which is linked to the Young's modulus, The shear modulus is very different between different tissues. You have very stiff tissues, soft tissues in the human body. So you see that the shear wave velocity here is between 1 and 10 meters per second in different tissues. So we applied this technique, and that was developed before for the diagnosis of breast cancer. And applied on the supersonic imaging system clinically. We use exactly the same system but for the myocardium, and the principle relies on two steps. First, you need to generate the shear wave. So to generate the shear wave, you can apply punch like this, but in the heart, it's very difficult to reach the heart. So you have to use other solutions such as the acoustic radiation force. Here, the acoustic radiation force is a force which is carried by the ultrasound itself, and the ultrasound wave, when it's focused on a location here, enables to push a little bit the tissue. It's a very small push, a few micrometer, but then it generates a shear wave that propagates laterally, and you can image the shear wave propagation with ultrafast imaging, because with conventional imaging you cannot see the propagation between two images. It completely disappeared. This is our first experiment on open chest animal. So we induce a shear wave in the myocardium here, and then we look at the propagation of the shear wave with ultrafast imaging. And when you do that at different time of the cardiac cycle here, this is our snapshot at the different time, you can see the wave propagation, which propagate at different velocities depending on the position in the time in the cardiac cycle. It's very rapid propagation in systole here, and then in diastole, very, very low propagation. So using the velocity, you can quantify the shear modulus. So this is the stiffness here as a function of time during one cardiac cycle. And you can see that in systole, you have a very strong increase of stiffness, big stiffening, and then a decrease of stiffness in diastole. So this is a parameter which is very similar to the pressure. It's expressed in kilopascal, and the curve is very similar. And this parameter is very interesting because you can use it to quantify the cardiac function. If you look at different part of this cardiac cycle, you have, for example, the diastolic stiffness. The diastolic stiffness is linked to the passive properties of the heart. If you look at the PV loop here, which is here obtained during a caval occlusion, you see that this passive elastic properties is described here by the end diastolic pressure volume relationship here. So it's really the elasticity of a passive muscle here. And for the active properties here, we have the systolic stiffness, which is also linked to the systolic part. And the, for example, here in the end systolic part, you have the end systolic elastance, which links the pressure and volume end diastolic point, and which is linked to the contractility. So it gives you here a new insight of many different index that are very useful for to characterize the cardiac function, and you can theoretically you can have all these index using non-invasive ultrasound here. This is an example of infarcted myocardium on an animal model here. So we created an infarct here using a coronary occlusion.
Can you explain a little bit more what is the relationship between the pressure and the
elasticity? You mean the link between the change in pressure during the cardiac cycle and the elasticity, or in general the
like in general, you said that
what you measure is a modulus that's expressed in kilopascals, so it's kind of like the pressure because it's also kilopascals, but
it's not
exactly like this too. My understanding is that more like the pressure is stress, not the modulus itself. So can you explain us a little bit better the link between intracardiac pressure and elasticity?
So in order to understand exactly the link, we have to look at the local relationship between the stress and strain. So this is not exactly this curve, because this curve is present the pressure, so it's the overall pressure in the heart, and the volume of the cavity. So this is a completely global view of what happened in the heart. Here, stiffness here is a local parameter. So stiffness is a local parameter. It relates the stress and the strain, so it's the slope of the stress-strain relationship. So stress is in kilopascal, strain is non-dimension, so it's also in kilopascal. But you can understand the meaning of these parameters using the PV loop. It's a great tool to understand this, because the slope here of the pressure volume relationship, especially in the diastole, is very similar to the slope of the stress strain curve locally. If you look at the local relationship, it's very similar to this.
And is it related to some energy loss also? Mm-hmm. I mean, which is suggested by, so in this case, actually, stiffness provides more energy loss in the heart or less?
I think you are speaking about the passive stiffness, the diastolic stiffness here. If you have an increased diastolic stiffness here, then you need to develop a higher pressure, higher active part in order to have the same deformation. Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
May not have enough oxygen in the myocardium.
Exactly. Okay. An increase of the myocardial contraction and failure. So this is just an example of the passive part. If you look at the passive part of the passive stiffness here during time, so it describes the experiment. So this is baseline. The shear modulus here is about 1 kilopascal, and then after infarction here you have more than 10 kilopascal. So you get really stiff tissue here after infarction. And in this other experiment, we just did a very short occlusion of the heart, and the occlusion was released, and then What happened is that the myocardium was stunned. So due to this occlusion, it was stunned. So it was not functioning correctly. The strain was, there was no strain, actually, for this part. But you can see that the stiffness here didn't change. It returned exactly to the baseline. So here we can see that there is a big difference between pathological myocardium here and stunned myocardium, which is still viable. So this is a very important information for the characterizing the myocardium.
Do you know what happens to the tissue if you look at the histological slices? Do you see what's happening in the tissue? Why is it stiffer?
You mean on the microscopic point of view?
What's happening?
Actually, there was no big change here because it was very acute experiment, very short experiment. But what is clear is that the cells are contracted, so you have contracture of the cells. So you can really see that it's stiff due to this. But there are also other probably other effects.
Yeah, if you go back to the previous slide, another thing that you also see is that after reperfusion, it actually gets stiffer. And that's when you get edema. So you really get water, which is accumulated, and that makes it stiffer. So the infarcted part before, when it's non-reperfused, it's less stiff than when it's reperfused. And that difference is edema. Mm-hmm. And when it's infarcted, is indeed you change the tissue contracture and things like that. Mm-hmm. So that's why it gets stiffer.
Yeah, you're completely right. We have a stiffness increasing before the infarction. So then we moved on also recently to transthoracic experiment, which are very challenging for us because you need to create the shear wave deep into the heart, and you need to have a good imaging quality to image a shear wave. So we succeeded to do that in most of the patients, and you see that here you can see the shear wave propagation. This is the myocardium in the short axis view here, and same myocardium in the long axis view. So we can measure stiffness and characterize the different stiffness along different view. I explain you after why we do that. So first we focused on healthy volunteer in order to measure what is the normal value of stiffness in the heart. So it is only one segment of the heart, the anteroseptal segment. And what we found here is that there is an increase of stiffness in the normal population with age, which is something that was expected or could be expected because many tissues get stiffer with age. And then we also investigated what happens in patients with a very strong pathology, such as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This patient has also diastolic dysfunction, so we really, really expected them to have very different stiffness. And this is what we found here. And they have, you see, the stiffness is much higher than normal patients for all age. But there is something else, because it seems to work great here. But there is some limitation here. You see, one big limitation is that if you perform this measurement in short axis view and in long axis view, you don't get the same value. So this is very very big trouble because we are trying to do a quantitative imaging tool, but you see that it's not quantitative. If you just change the probe here, you get a very different stiffness here. And this is due to the structure of the heart. If you look at the image of the, this is an image from MRI, diffusion tensor imaging. So you can have a very nice description of the fiber direction. And you see that the fiber direction, of course, is very complex into the heart. It changed also inside the wall. There is transmural change of the fibers. And of course, shear waves are very sensitive to the fibers because the fiber direction is in the fiber direction you get very stiff tissue. It's difficult to deform the fibers, but in the lateral direction you get a soft measurement here. So to overcome this problem, we developed the 3D approach, because the 3D approach, in theory, you completely solve this problem because you get access to the entire displacement. Just for one push, you get access to all the direction. And this is an example in phantoms here. So we applied the acoustic radiation force in the center, and then we image with 3D ultrafast imaging the propagation of the shear wave. And then we did this. This was done by Mafalda Correa during her PhD thesis in anisotropic phantom. So it's something which mimics a tissue with fibers. It has some fiber alignment here. And if you look at the shear wave propagation here, then you can see that it's anisotropic and it's moving faster in this direction than laterally. You get ellipse instead of a circle here. And so from this measurement, then you have a great description of the mechanics here. So for each point of this voxel, you can then apply an analysis of the what is the main axis of the propagation, what is the short axis, and then retrieve something which is similar to what is used in MRDTI using ellipse here.
Sorry, Eric. Yeah. We have a question regarding the previous slide.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking about the implication for the one before with the stiffness. Well, you found the relationship between the between the stiffness and the age.
Yeah.
So I have to question first what is the location for the long axis view in the long axis view. Why was the location of this mm-hmm. point?
Yeah, the same location. The same location than in short axis, or almost
okay,
the same.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So it's interesting.
Yeah, just a change of angles or rotation of the probe.
And now regarding the relationship, the linear relationship that you found between the age mm-hmm. and the shear wave velocity, I was wondering whether because elasticity and the shear wave velocity is a load-dependent parameter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I was wondering whether this is a real marker of the stiffness of the tissue, mm-hmm. or is it a marker of the pressure? Because it is known that systolic pressure increases with age.
Yeah, that's
so
an
excellent question. Did you find a relationship with pressure and?
No, actually, the correlation with pressure was really bad.
So you had a homogeneous.
Yeah, but there is a limitation because pressure, diastolic pressure, is very, very difficult to estimate. So we don't have the actual diastolic pressure. So it's there is limitation. But when we do a diastolic measurement at the end diastolic, we expect to be very. Low sensitive to the load because in this part the muscle has quite a linear linear behavior with pressure. It's very low pressure.
Okay, this one was in diastole, not in systole.
In diastole. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
But there might be, of course, mm-hmm. some dependence. Yeah. Okay, so I'm done with this part, and then I want to move on to the high sensitivity coronary blood flow imaging using ultrafast imaging. So I want to show you here that ultrafast imaging can be used also to image ultra-slow motion. And it's very interesting to image ultra-slow motion. So I will go rapidly because you already see that. But in Doppler imaging, because it relies on focus in transmit, what you want to do is to estimate the velocity of the blood flow in each of the points in this line. So you apply several times the transmit, then you look at how it moves, and then you move on to the next line. So that means that for each line, you have very, very few samples. What the great advantage of ultrafast imaging when you do that is that for each line, actually, you have the full samples because you are imaging all the points during all the acquisition here. So when you look at the final image, which is here, it's power Doppler, so it's intensity of the Doppler here. In conventional imaging, that's a brain of a rat. You can see the main arteries, but not all the small vessels. When you look at this image here, you can distinguish all the small vessels, just due to the increase in sensitivity. Here, you lose resolution, you lose contrast with ultrafast imaging, but you see that you have better image because you increase the sensitivity of the Doppler estimation here. So this is to show you what main application in the brain. So this high sensitivity can enable to do a functional imaging with ultrasound, which was not possible before. Functional imaging in the brain was restricted to MRI or PET or other things, but not ultrasound. And if you look at this experiment, so this experiment is a basic experiment in functional imaging. Here you move the whisker here, and we know that each of these whiskers is related to a zone in the brain, in the parietal cortex here. And due to the activation of this zone and the neurovascular coupling, then there is a higher amount of blood which is required in this region. And so the blood flow increases. And this is what we see here in this video. So when we move the whisker here, then you see that this location moves and also a deeper region. So this has very important application, for example, in the brain of babies using transfontanellar imaging. Here you can see all the vessels, arteries and veins in the brain. And then we can use it to do functional imaging. And finally, this is just to answer one question that was before about the resolution of ultrasound. There is a way to increase the resolution of ultrasound in some case, and this is one interesting part. It's we call ultrafast superlocalization. It's how to image very small vessels. It works only for Doppler imaging, but how to image very small vessels of 10 micrometer using bubbles, microbubbles, contrast agent. Because if you can individually track all the bubbles, then you can theoretically know exactly where they are, super localize it, and then create the map of the vasculature with a microscopic level. And this is what was done here by Claudia Errico and Olivier Couture and Nickel Tanter here in the lab. And you see that you can have access to all the very, very small vessels at the microscopic level, even at high depths. Well, this is considered a high depth for us at 1 centimeter depth here. So this is a way to increase the resolution. So for the heart, so what are the vessels in the heart? If you look at this slice with it's a microscopic slice with optical contrast. Here you can see that there are mainly the big vessels, big coronary vessels, LAD, LCX here, which runs on the epicardium. And then you have smaller vessels that goes inside the myocardium here, which are on the order of 300 micrometer. And then finally you have very, very small vessels, which are capillaries and arterioles inside here. So with ultrasound, what we can expect to see if we have the sensitivity is probably not this not this part, or unless you use the microscopic technique, which hasn't not done in the heart. But we can expect to see all these vessels of 200 micrometers which are inside the heart. And this is very interesting because in clinical application, there is no modality that can depict this kind of vessels. If you look at all the technique that measure the blood flow here on the coronary, you mainly see the big vessels outside here, but not the smaller vessel inside. And of course, they have also many limitations on the frame rate, ionization, cost, and everything. But with ultrasound, if you increase the sensitivity with ultrafast imaging, histologically possible, and this is what we did. So we acquired many frames of the myocardium here with ultrafast imaging, and then we used a small frame blocks here of 25 milliseconds, and then we analyzed it in order to retrieve the blood flow. So we developed a special filter here for this based on the singular value decomposition in order to separate blood flow from tissue, which is very difficult in the heart because the tissue is moving and blood flow are moving, and sometimes they are moving at the same speed, so it's very, very difficult to separate them. So you have to use other tricks than only the velocity to separate. I will pass here, and then after you separate the blood flow from the tissue, then you can display here the map of the blood flow here, and you can see the intramural here coronary arteries inside the muscle, and you can also analyze what is the direction of the blood flow. This is an example here. You see that the main direction was here in blue, so. It was downwards. So this is an example of the movie, ultrafast movie here, with the blood flow. So you can see first the veins, and then in blue the arteries. There is a clear separation between the two phases because the heart is perfused by arteries only in diastole. So before this phase you see the vein in red, and here in blue, so downwards the arteries. So we can analyze all these coronary flows during the different phases, and what we try to do is also to look at the quantitative meaning of this, and can we use this information to quantify blood flows? Because one limitation here is it relies on Doppler imaging, and Doppler imaging is dependent on the angle, as you know. So you cannot have access to the real velocity or to quantify the flow rate or anything like that. But yeah.
Can I ask you something about are they eigenmodes of your SVD? I mean the
yes.
So do you look at the eigenmodes frame by frame? Like it's matrix of the.
Mm-hmm. Actually, you have to look at the data. In a different way, so you have to look at the data as a matrix of space and time.
Yes.
And then to analyze, to do the singular value decomposition on this part, in order to separate the eigenvector space and time. And by using these two analyses, then you can really differentiate blood and tissues, because they don't have the similar behavior in space and time. That's maybe.
Well, the separation between time and space is not clear, but I can.
Yeah. You see, tissue moves quite more slowly, but in space it moves coherently. So tissue moves as you take a piece of tissue, it moves the same way everywhere almost. But the blood flow, it's individual scatterers, and they moved completely independently in all the points. Mm-hmm. So you can really analyze what is the difference in temporal, what is the spatio-temporal difference.
Between yeah, because the
yeah. I mean the your frames at each time, say, are three-dimensional.
I mean, mm-hmm. you are using three-dimensional image.
That's only 2D imaging.
Ah, okay. Yeah. So then, okay. Yeah. Because I'm looking at the matrix.
But it works the same for 3D.
So you do it frame section by section for the 3D. I mean, you have
When you apply this technique in 3D, you have to look at the same way. So you have to look at space and time. It can be okay. Space in 2D or in 3D. It doesn't
okay.
change.
Matrix.
Yeah, yeah.
SVD, in linear algebra, you apply it for 2D matrix.
Yes.
So then maybe
yes.
the 3D, you will like
no.
extend.
Yeah. No. Actually, we applied it on 2D matrix. You have to rearrange your matrix with space and time only.
Okay.
Yeah. Because you won't really want to separate space and time. So it's not quantitative, as you understood, but you can quantify the change. Of blood flows, and this is a proof of contact experiment on animals, where you have the a gold standard flow meter here, which give the ratio between the different flows during an experiment. In this experiment, you have a very short occlusion of the coronary artery, and then you get hyperemia of the
blood flow. Excuse me,
what is PDI? It's a polar velocity integrals. So it's a different way to compute a power Doppler by taking into account the velocity. Because power Doppler is a great tool to quantify, say, more or less the number of scatters that are moving in your thing. But you don't have information about the velocity. If you integrate with the velocity here, you can have something which is correlated to the flow rate. What we show are different timing of this experiment. It was a good correlation. So we can perform non-invasively with ultrasound, without contrast agent. We can perform an evaluation of the coronary flow reserve, which is done by measuring the flow rate for different conditions here. And this was obtained here using adenosine ejection, which dilate all the veins and the arteries. And finally, to answer your question,
because it is very interesting. So we have a question regarding the coronary flow reserve.
Okay, thank you. You want to estimate the coronary flow reserve from your techniques, mm-hmm. But why do you need the whole vasculature? Because if you have, the flow rate at the inlet, mm-hmm. which is much easier to get, I think, from technique,
yeah.
I think it should be enough.
Yeah, but when you have this measurement in the inlet, you have a very global measurement, which is of course linked to
the micro. Coronary flow reserve is measured
That's the way. But if you want to move on to diastolic, which is closer to the microvasculature, mm-hmm. and there are many microvascular diseases in the heart, then you need to go to a level which is closer to the microvasculature. Mm-hmm. Of course, it will be better to look directly at the microvascular system, but we don't see the microvascular systems here. But if you have access to the intermediate compartment, then it gives you new insight in this.
So do you think that your approach would be accurate enough to detect local ischemia?
We don't know yet. We don't know yet, but we hope that it can improve this. Yeah. Yeah. And this is to answer your question. So it works similarly in 3D. So that's an experiment done by Mafalda. You show it's a small part of the myocardium here. It's an animal, open chest, so the very simple experiment. But you see here on the myocardium wall, so here it's moving, but you can see the veins here inside the myocardium, and then the arteries during the diastolic phase here. So of course 3D imaging is very interesting here, because all these vessels are completely tortuous and has a complex distribution in 3D. I don't know if I have time. Yeah.
How far is that from being clinical, meaning do you envision that this would be doable transthoracically? Mm-hmm. And which parts of the heart would be accessible?
That's a difficult question. so far I haven't shown this, but so far we tried to translate this into clinics in children. Because it's easier for us. Actually, we have a linear probe for this experiment, quite high frequency, it's 6 megahertz, which is okay for pediatric application. I don't have the picture here, but it works in pediatric patients. So you can see all the vascular pattern in the myocardium. But I think your question is more about the application to the adult, and I don't have the answer yet, because you have to move on to sector probes, phased array, so the sensitivity, the resolution will be completely different, and probably we will not be able to get the same quality. But there might be some possibilities to really see the big vessels. We already tried on ourselves, actually, and we can see the big vessels in the septum or in other. Yes.
Well, I assume that the other application could be kind of during surgery, intraoperative, mm-hmm. because in principle you have these pericardial probes that you can put on. Currently, when you look in practice, they're not used that much because they don't give that much additional value with regard to transesophageal. But if you could get something which is perfusion related to some territories, I could assume that it would be like a new application, and maybe surgeons or anesthesiologists would go back to pericardial imaging, which is now just because of practicalities and no additional value, not used that much. So.
I completely agree that that would be a great application of this. And also the transesophageal imaging approach would be also very interesting because here you with transesophageal imaging at a higher frequency, closer to the heart, you will see, with a good quality.
That's a question I wanted to ask. I never seen application with transesophageal application for that. What is the reason? Is really to build the probe is the main difficulty because
it sounds
logical to go to that in fact mm-hmm. for adults because then you're closer and you can apply exactly what you have done for mm-hmm. pediatric.
Actually, we applied this to transesophageal imaging, not the blood flow part, but the myocardial stiffness part. We did this in a project with high foot therapy.
Okay.
Which was also transesophageal. So everything was integrated in a transesophageal system. And we were able to do shear wave imaging and everything. But there are very big difficulties for us because, first of all, the animal model is very complex. You don't have a good large animal model for transesophageal imaging, so you need to go to human or to primate, big monkeys, something like this. So it makes it difficult.
Yeah.
And then on humans, for us, it's a bit difficult because you have also all the regulatory issues, which are quite different from transthoracic point of view. So I think that's the main reason. Yeah. And also, for the clinics, it's not the same, actually. When you see a patient, they really don't like to have a transesophageal imaging.
Yes, of course.
Do you have enough time to continue, or?
Yeah.
It's already an hour. It's already an hour. Okay, thank you. So I will continue with also blood flow, but blood flow at high velocity. So for this part, it's ultrafast imaging or force can provide a very, very nice things. So far, when you look at the literature in 4D flow imaging, so you have this beautiful image from MRI that describes all the blood flow velocity in space and time. But of course, it has many limitations. It's expensive. You need to acquire several cardiac cycles. It's not practical. Anything. Ultrasound has a big advantage for imaging blood flows, and ultrasound is already very good in what we call vector flow imaging, and you see some examples here of different techniques used. This is a technique based on speckle tracking with high frame rate imaging, and you can see the interventricular communication on babies here. This is another example with 3D imaging that enables to reconstruct the flow profile on a big artery here, like this, the real 3D profile on a plane here. So in this study, we wanted to also to see how ultrafast imaging can provide the real 3D full quantification of blood flows, and this is what we done during Mafalda PhD thesis here. So the principle here is to send plane waves, some plane wave on the medium here, and then to receive. Oh, sorry. And then to receive to receive the ultrasound using sub-aperture that are tilted with tilted angles in order to perform Doppler estimation at different angles. Because you understand that Doppler estimation can only perform estimation of the axial motion. But if you do several angles like this, then you can estimate the different velocity along this direction. Then when you do that, you have also to filter out the tissue. And we did that using the same clutter filter that was described previously, using spatial temporal singular value decomposition. And finally, you need to inverse all this Doppler measurement to get back to the velocity. And the great thing, of course, with the full velocity estimation is that at the end, you get the real velocity vector, and then you can perform a volumetric flow rate estimation, which is very difficult to perform with ultrasound and to be accurate. So these are some examples that was performed with a flow phantom. It mimics a big artery, like a carotid artery here. And when you do 3D ultrafast imaging, first you can really estimate all the velocities of the blood flow here. So the blood flow is moving transversely. So normally in conventional Doppler ultrasound, you don't have any Doppler signal here. So this is the worst case. And here you can reconstruct the 3D profile. So you can have the good profile here of the with a parabolic flow here, and which is a detail here. And when you look at the volumetric flow rate that you can estimate by taking sections here and integrating all the velocity over that section, here you found very, very good estimation when you compare it to a gold standard flow meter. Here up to very high velocities of 1 meter per second, which are the velocities that you can find in carotid arteries, for example. And this is one experiment, in vivo experiment performed by Mafalda on a carotid artery. So it's a 3D view of the blood flow. And then you can have the full description of the blood flow during the cardiac cycle. Here you see increased velocity during the cardiac cycle. And you can analyze, of course, the profile here, point by point, and you see a different velocity here. Or analyze the flow rate here. And this is some two examples that we found in male and female volunteers. So that's a good tool to estimate high velocities, but also it's a good tool to look at the complex distribution of blood flow in arteries. And this is an example in vivo at the bifurcation level here. And you can see during systole here, you have a vortex, a creation during the high velocity ejection. That can be depicted by this technique. So that's very interesting also to really explore a very complex flow. And this is what Damien also has shown in the heart using a vortex imaging in the heart. Well, finally, I will finish rapidly with another application of ultrafast imaging is how to map myocardial fiber orientation using ultrafast imaging. In this work, we use ultrafast imaging to obtain some properties of the speckle. So as Olivier explained, the properties of the speckle are very interesting because it contains a lot of information about the medium. And especially if you look at what is a speckle that is created by a focus wave here, and then when you receive all the signals, you can analyze spatially what is the similarity between the speckle that you receive at all this point, all this element. And if you do that, it's a very simple operation. You need to correlate the signal received on one element to the other element, like this. And you can express this In terms of distance, spatial distance, so you can statistically average this for the same distance, for this element and this one, and recreate a coherence function which expresses the similarity between these two pairs of elements. And if you do that in normal random scatterers, you obtain what is predicted by it's called the Wanzita-Zernike theorem. It's something which has here a pyramidal shape, which is actually linked to the shape of the focus here. So it's interesting because it gives you a view of the focus from the backscatter signal. But now, if you have ultrafast imaging, you can do the same and use synthetic emission. If I use synthetically the plane wave emission to recreate focus everywhere in the medium, so you can create this coherent function everywhere in the volume and analyze this coherent function, which will give you information about the focus, but also what's inside the focus. Because if you have anisotropic scatterers, which is the case in muscles, so in muscles you have scatterers distributed along fibers, then when you look at the coherence function, you don't have any more nice isotropic coherence function, but you have elongated coherence function in the direction of the scatter distribution here. So if you look at, this is a myocardial sample in vitro, and we looked at different depths in the wall here, and what we observed is that we don't get the same direction depending on the depths transmurally, which is known to be related to the fiber orientation, which is not the same in the wall on the epicardium or on the endocardium. So you can analyze this in a volume and perform tensor diffusion analysis like fiber tracking and obtain the fibers orientation and the distribution in the volume, like this. And this is interesting because it can be applied in vivo on a beating heart. It's quite fast. You need a few tens of transmit to do this estimation. And this is an example of the dynamics of the fibers estimated by our technique during the cardiac cycle.
I have a question.
Do you have any idea of the precision of your measurement? Because when I saw that, I have the impression that you apply some regularization to have nice-looking directional fibers. Mm-hmm. But of course, one of the applications of that is to study, for example, the non-structures of the fibers locally because of anything. And so if you regularize, of course, you will miss this.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it's linked to the precision. So do you have any idea?
Yeah. It's difficult to answer to this question. You're right, and the display here has been obtained by a regularization algorithm with fiber tracking, and so on. So we didn't develop this algorithm. It's a algorithm from MRI. But what we investigated is can we validate it against, for example, histological analysis, and we did it, and we had a good accuracy actually, not bad. It depends actually on samples, but when you look with histology at the different layers and the fiber orientation, it's really well. It agrees really well with our distribution here. It's difficult to really quantify the accuracy here, but it's on the order of 10 degrees here. Yeah.
Did you try in the presence of necrosis or fibrosis?
No, we haven't. No, we haven't. Yeah. No, we haven't because it would be interesting. But you see, for now, it's very limited to a small small field of view. So, well, we are now more interested in characterizing the myocardium of human patients with disease, but with homogeneous disease like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or fibrosis or something like this, but with something that with a fibro disarray that could be characterized.
In what way?
A disarray, the a change of fibro orientation.
Okay.
The autocorrelation function that you use for to get actually these estimates, can you do it? It appears to be a normalized autocorrelation, but there is a slightly different one that you can do in with Fourier domain, special Fourier domain. By so-called, correlation, which is also normalized in another way, component by component. Does it lead to the same kind of result, or is it totally independent?
It leads to the same, more or less, the same kind of results. But we haven't really studied what is the difference between the two. But we obtain at the end the same kind of...
But does it enter in the, in the... theorem, actually, can you actually use this kind of concept also in the or is the Zernike one dependent on your method of normalization?
No. It's not dependent on the method of normalization. Because you it changed. I mean, the method of normalization changed a little bit the way the ellipsoid looks, but more you get more or less the same angles at the end.
I mean, it's much more advantageous, of course, to do this in with
Fourier
domain.
In the Fourier domain, of course.
Less computation. That's
yes.
That's what I want.
Yeah, I agree completely. Yeah. This is a good way to for faster implementation and okay. So I have. Finished. So at the end, just to summarize, I hope that I have been able to show you that ultrafast imaging is a very interesting way to have new quantitative information about tissues and blood flow, especially for a very rapid phenomenon such as shear waves in myocardial stiffness, tissue motion. I haven't shown tissue motion here, but it's also very interesting for tissue motion and blood flow velocities. And especially in 3D, but also for low velocity phenomena such as the fiber orientation, small vessels, due to increase of sensitivity in physics. And thank you very much.
Mathieu, so thank you. So another question.
On the back.
All right. So linking the last part of your talk with the first part of your talk, so you have fiber orientation and you have shear wave speed. So the shear wave speed depends on the depth in the myocardium. So when you measure one speed, what do you actually measure? It's obviously fiber dependent.
Yeah.
But you only extract one measurement per location, so is there a limitation here? Is that okay?
Yeah, that's what exactly. And that's why when you have a short axis view, long axis view, you get different values. And so at the end, what we need is the 3D measurement in order to be able to have the complete biomechanics. Well, of course, but the heart is complex, and you really need the 3D imaging of this.
I get it.
We started to do this, and this was done by Victor, so we can maybe answer better the question. But Victor also did this in his PhD thesis. We did some transthoracic experiment on ourselves, we targeted just one wall, one location, and we were able to look at the systolic and diastolic phase of the fibers. But of course, there are many limitations with the signal-to-noise ratio that we need to deal with, a very low signal-to-noise ratio, which make it really challenging. So there is a lot of work to improve this.
About the fiber direction, mm-hmm. and also you can measure the shear wave in different direction of the ultrasound. And is there any theoretical model which can really link the fiber direction to this velocity of the shear wave?
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course there are okay. There are several. The simple one is really to take an analytical description of the biomechanics in a simple anisotropic model, such as a transverse isotrope model, but which is a very simplistic description of the real mechanics. Then you can move on to more and more complex description. But then at the end, it's really complex. You have a lot of parameters in this.
And another question, it's what kind of this isotropic material property, the scale of this this kind of tissue? I don't know. I mean, we measure this kind of velocity in which, how big is the scale? I mean,
yeah.
Centimeter, millimeter, and
In shear wave, when we image the shear, when we quantify the shear wave velocity, actually we are looking at a volume which is small, but not microscopic. And so we integrate all these characteristics in this volume. It's on the order of a millimeter, a few millimeter.
Thank you.
Let's maybe going a little bit further with this discussion, because what you're saying also is like what you do is you look at bulk in a way, properties in some ways, and also at apparent properties. For example, when you look at stiffness, it's at a certain time, and the relation between the passive stiffness and what you measure is, well, actually we don't really know in some ways, because you could say indeed that in diastasis what you measure there as stiffness would be the stiffness, but on the other hand, the heart is never still. Even in an athlete with long diastasis, you still have flow going around, which would change the properties and things like that. So in that sense, I think it's very, very interesting information, but it's, as you say, it's extremely complex to try to interpret it then later on. And also the links with the pressure volume loops and so on, it's like that needs still a lot of work. Similarly with the fibers, we're now trying to look with synchrotron imaging at the fibers at a resolution of half a micrometer. And then you see that there are no fibers. It's just a very complex arrangement. And the changes also, you don't know. So the thing is, like, this brings us, as you say, like one step closer to where we at some point might want to go. But it's really important to keep in mind what we're looking at. And especially things like simulations and analysis and so on are needed in order to understand it. And I really like the fact that you do it from the more theoretical side, and then you start to do from the machines, the imaging, but at the same time go as immediately or as quickly as possible to animal experiments, to humans, to at least see what might be the value, because in the end it's so complex, although we might try to understand, we don't know exactly what we're measuring, but it might be clinically useful and relevant, and that's the way that we have to look at it, I think.
Yeah, I completely agree. And we talked about fiber orientation, the stiffness, but also there is strain analysis is very important here to include in this view, and the microscopic level also is very important.
A question related to this question is that when you said you measure the shear stresses for the passive part and the active part, don't you have like difficulties when measuring the stress is in the active part because you have other contractions?
Actually, what is challenging in the active part is that the muscle is stiff, so the shear wave velocity is high, and when it's very high, it's very difficult to quantify accurately. So that's the main challenge here. But okay. I would say for example, maybe you mean the motion or something like this. Because at this high frame rate, you always find a good, good period of time where it's not moving at all. So, yeah, even in systole or in diastole. Yeah.
So there's other work, and by you as well, I believe, that's looking at the valves. When they close, they generate a wave. Maybe a shear wave, maybe something else we don't know, but it generates a wave, and you can measure the speed of that wave. What do you think of those techniques versus what you're doing? Is that an alternative, something complementary? What I'd like your opinion on this.
Yeah, that's also very interesting. I haven't talked about this because, because we are still working on this and to see how we could apply it to a clinical application and medicine. But you're right. There are motion that are induced naturally by the heart, such as the valve closure, which creates a very strong shear wave. These shear waves are very interesting to quantify the stiffness. But they are created at very specific timing, so it's there are limitations about what is the interest of this timing, and also the propagation of the shear wave is quite complex. You don't control it, so there is also work to really understand how it propagates in the heart. But I think it's an interesting way to get access to shear wave velocity. Thank you.
Innovation and you. Philips.